Well, welcome back to Tucker Allen Live on this cold and snowy day here in the St. Louis metropolitan area. Welcome back. We'll continue to bring you this every Friday at 1 o'clock, just for a short 15 minutes or so to talk about topics specifically in estate and elder law. And today is obviously no different, but go ahead and check us out at tuckerallen.com. You can find out more information, more resources, and more information, more importantly. It may stimulate today's conversation, may stimulate questions for you, and you can certainly go there and get more information. Today, again, we're joined as a return guest by one of the Tucker Allen attorneys, Teresa Yao. Welcome.
Hi, thanks for having me again.
Well, thanks. And today we want to talk about amending trust amendments and restatements. I know that a lot of people hear about amendment and then the restatement may confuse them. So let's just talk about why it's important to update documents like the trust first and start there.
Absolutely. So contrary to popular belief, estate plans are not just like a one and done deal, right? Like it's great to take that first step because establishing that first step is kind of what gives you the like lasting peace of mind. But you also want to make sure that your estate plan keeps morphing with your life circumstances. That means updating it as your life changes. So I think especially with a trust, after you create a trust and you do your homework, which is really great, we encourage you to do your homework as soon as possible. And what I mean by that is titling your different assets with your trust so that your trust is your beneficiary. And that's a one and done deal. But if your life changes and you want to update your trustee, your trustee moves out of state, your beneficiaries, if they're your kids, they grow up and you kind of want to change how you distribute things to them. Those are all things to consider and why it's so important to monitor your trust and update them as things come.
And we've talked about this on either virtual town halls or our Tucker Allen Live here. We've talked about amending and changing trustees. And we've even mentioned, and I'm going to bring it up again, the legacy protection program that Tucker Allen offers. It's one of those things where you would make those minor changes for free if you're a member of the legacy protection program, right?
Absolutely. So this is exactly where that would come in really helpful. And honestly, a lot of times when we have clients come in and they do that first step and they're signing their initial documents, that first set of estate plans, they're asking me about making changes down the road, especially if they have minor kids. And a lot of times when people have minor kids, they would want their kids to be the agents or the trustees when their kids become adults. So it's kind of inevitable that they'll make changes. And then so that's when I bring up the legacy protection plan, because that's a thing where if you're making changes across all your different documents in your estate plan, the legacy protection plan can really save you quite a bit.
So let's talk about the process. Let's talk about the process, whether you have to do a new trust, amend the trust, what is it that you need to do? And I'm sure it's dependent upon what you want to do.
Exactly. So with a trust, we normally don't like to create a whole new trust. And that's because we respect the work that you've done, the homework that where you title all the different assets. If we were to create a whole new trust, then that means you'd have to redo all of your homework because the new trust would have a new name. If it has a new name, then that means you have to update all the beneficiaries that you've set up. So a lot of times when people come in to update their trust, it's either an amendment or a restatement depending on the changes that they're trying to make.
So in the restatement, maybe give me more examples on when it's appropriate to do a restatement versus amendment. Because I think about just amending the trust for a trustee or a guardian designation or financial, but what would be really the restatement part?
Yeah, so I will say amendments are more frequent than restatements because normally restatements are really used if you want to change the entire like structure of your trust. Like if you want to change your distribution structure from like outright to beneficiaries to lifetime trust for beneficiaries. So I always use the basket metaphor for a trust, right? Yeah, so you create this basket on that initial day of signing. A restatement is essentially the same basket, but you're essentially changing all the like material, that's making the basket. So that it's still the same basket, but the terms, the structure of it change entirely. So I would say that is a common way to go to do a restatement. Another thing is if you have personal trustees like family or friends as trustees, but you want to update it to become a corporate trustee. When you appoint a corporate trustee, a lot of times these trust companies want to include specialized language, which might mean changes all across different provisions in the trust. So that would incur a restatement.
So imagine things like the age of the trust. I mean, if it's 20 plus years and there may be significant, I mean, like I think a week ago we talked about the CARES Act, or I think it was the CARES Act or the Secure Act, that made some changes with regards to IRAs that you need to put new provisions in. And I imagine based on the age of the trust and the complications and what may need to be changed, the guts, there may be so much that needs to be changed. It's just better to just start over.
Do a restatement. Yeah. So normally we do amendments, but if somebody comes in with like a 20-year trust, we're like, it's just going to be a lot easier. And really it's going to be a lot more thorough because so much has been added in terms of the coverage or how thorough your trust can be in the last 20 years. So we just do a restatement and give the full meat to their trust.
So if they're thinking about updating their trust, what other considerations should they be thinking about? You know, you've got the wills and the POAs, you know, hanging out there. Should they be thinking about that as well?
Yeah, I think they definitely should be thinking about the other documents, especially because one of the most common updates that come across their table is just changing a name. And a lot of times when you appoint somebody as a trustee in your trust, this person normally is prevalent across your different documents as well. Like in your will, maybe they're an executor in your will, or they're your financial power of attorney, healthcare power of attorney, because they're the responsible person in your life. And then, so if you're updating them in your trust, then that means, you know, all your documents work together. So if you're updating in your trust, you're probably updating them in the other documents as well. And I think just to bring us back to that legacy protection plan, that's where it's so important, because you're not just updating your trust, you're updating, if it's like a couple or something, you're updating a trust, two wills, two financial powers of attorney, two healthcare powers of attorney. And if you're making changes to each of these documents, it could get pretty pricey. Whereas like under the legacy protection plan, it kind of is all bundled together.
So you don't have to be a previous client of Tucker Allen to be in the legacy protection program. You can call and find out more information, I imagine, and, and try to sign up, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I wasn't really avoiding it, but I'm pretty good at procrastinating. I needed a trust. When I found Tucker Allen, all our questions were answered, all of our fears allayed.
You want your wishes in place, so there's no guessing, no stress on the children.
Basically, they talk about what you need, what's important to you. It was more conversational, really very simple.
And I think it's important because we talk a lot every week or in our virtual town hall about changes, whether they be family changes or you want to change a designation of the trustee. It's a good idea to frequently or annually, or I want your opinion, how often maybe should someone be looking at their trust to determine what changes they should be making?
I would say best practice probably every year, just because a lot happens in 1 year. I mean, look at 2020.
Yeah, right.
Like a lot can happen in 1 year. So it doesn't really take that much work. And under our legacy protection plan, I know that it includes like an annual review with an attorney. Like an attorney from Tucker Allen will meet with you just to go over, hey, is everything still okay? If not, what are the small changes that we need to do to update it?
And those are no charge to do that annual review.
Yeah, that's included
in the program. Got it.
Exactly.
So obviously when you look at 2020 disaster craziness, you know, I think it becomes a daunting task for people as they think about, maybe they don't have a trust and they're thinking, well, I have to modify this thing. I have to pay attention to it all the time. Again, they don't have to. I mean, that's the whole point of the legacy protection program. You've got people watching, listening, they think I've got to do it. You know, if I don't do it now, when am I going to do it? And then they're thinking, well, oh, it's just a burden. I don't want to think about it every year. And so that's really why you want to join those things together, where we'll remind them, I imagine, every year, hey, it's time to just do a quick review. We can do it via Zoom. We can do it on the phone. Let's just double check to make sure everything's okay. And that's kind of how the system works, I assume.
Yeah, absolutely. Because I think it's really tempting after you create your estate plan, you get your big binder, it's beautiful, and you put it in some safe place in your house, but then you carry on with your lives. And it's really kind of hard to keep track of everything, especially if it's just an annual review. Whereas if you sign up for the program, at least like we're monitoring that for you. We'll see, oh, okay, they signed up for the program a year ago. Attorney, look it up. And then we can call you, set up a meeting, whatever you're comfortable with. And then just either re-explain how everything is set up and like answer any questions that you might have just come up throughout the year, or just clarify how it's set up too. So
yeah. a little bit off the subject, but as we talk about your trust and your will, I was there, it sits on a shelf and it gathers dust and I haven't cracked it open. You know, you just, it like creaks when you open it up because you haven't opened in so long. The Go package. I think you were the one, months ago.
We talked about it. Yeah.
This Go package. I mean, I think when you think about it is there's someone watching right now. They took the right steps. They did their will. They did their trust, but they haven't done anything else with it. Maybe they haven't funded it, but that Go package, which is kind of, maybe you can just talk about real briefly, we have a little bit of time left, what that is and why it's important.
The Go package is essentially your estate plan plus other documents to supplement kind of the ease of your estate plan being carried out for your trustee. Mm-hmm. So in addition to just your trust document, your wills, your powers of attorney and everything, we also include other worksheets, like for example, a digital asset inventory where you can keep track of your social media accounts, your email accounts, login information. Obviously keep all this in a safe place and only accessible to the people that you trust so that if something were to happen, practicality, like speaking, your trustees, your agents are able to know how to close out your digital life, know exactly what needs to be done for the trust and what assets are in the trust, what's not, hopefully nothing. Yep. Right.
Yeah, Bitcoin. I mean, just an article, there's a guy out there that has $220 million in Bitcoin and he lost the password.
And yes, that's terrible.
he has, I guess it's eight attempts to guess the password. He's through number six and now he doesn't know what to do. That would be a great place for the Go package to put your password in the Go package so that when you pass, your heirs can find the password to your $220 million Bitcoin account.
Absolutely. With cryptocurrency accounts, really the onus is on you to keep it safe because right now you have that special key and if that special key is lost, you're kind of out of luck. So.
Absolutely. So, all right, Teresa, thanks for joining and talking about kind of the things. Again, we oftentimes people hear words like restatement. They have no idea what that means and we try to simplify and break it down for them. So thanks for joining again.
Well, thanks for having me.
Well, continue to tune in every Friday, same time. We'll be the same place, 1 o'clock, right here on Tuck Around Live on Facebook. We'll just bring you a very, very quick snippet of some information and get you some details and really encourage you to research further. So reach out to us. You can find us across social and you can go to tuckerallen.com. You can schedule an appointment. If you want more information on the website, you can have that consult on the phone, Zoom, just like this, or in person where appropriate. Keep in mind your health and safety and responsibility. So until next Friday, also tune into our podcasts and our virtual town halls. Until next Friday, have a great weekend.